Well, the weather's just absolutely miserable out here. It's rainy and foggy and cold and just overall blah. So I figured it'd be a good time to try to restore the turntable and the Magnavox console radio. I'll show you guys what I'm talking about. This is the Magnavox Magnasonic console stereo that I made a video about not too long ago. And the only other problem that it had, besides the burned out dial lights, was that the turntable is just a bit bound up. The grease is dried out and everything. It's not in terrible shape, but definitely could use a bit of a restoration. And I got a shop light back there to provide some lighting. And what I'm going to end up doing is taking this thing out. It is held on at three points, here, here, and back there, with these clips that I've already got removed. And they just kind of slide on there like that. And then I'll take off the rubber isolator, and then the power connector, and also the left and right audio channels. And then basically it'll just go ahead and lift on out of there. And because these audio cables aren't labeled or color-coded, I decided to disconnect them right here at the power amp, because this connector just goes on one way, so there's no chance of getting the channels reversed. So you can kind of see some of the dried up grease there, just really kind of gummy and waxy feeling. But overall, it looks to be in pretty good shape. I think all that's going to need is just a overall cleaning and reapplication of some grease, and it should be good to go, because some of the action right here is still pretty loose and free, so it's not stuck. So I think I can get this thing working fairly well. So let me pause it here and get this thing out and get a better look at it. So now I've got the turntable completely removed. It wasn't too hard of a job. And one of the things I've noticed was, I'm kind of surprised about, is it's made in England. And here's some of the other labels on it. Turn the camera around so you can see better. It's actually a Magnavox Micromatic turntable, and I wonder if that's a re-label of another popular turntable made in England. I'm not really sure. I haven't had any time to do any research. But you can see some of the problem areas just due to old age with this dried up grease. But not terribly bad. Not very dusty. I believe that the motor still works, 117 volt motor, and overall in pretty good shape. The gear teeth don't look worn or anything like that. So I think what I can do is I can just get away with taking a regular paper towel and maybe some alcohol if I need to. And that's, here's a really bad spot here. Completely dry, it's almost like wax. Doesn't even come off on my hand. I think what I can do is just wipe a little bit of that off with this towel, just like this, and just kind of go through it and basically identify all these friction surfaces or bearing surfaces, and just work some white lithium grease in there and see if I can get this thing back to life. So I'm gonna, wouldn't bore you with all the details. I don't think I need to disassemble everything like I initially thought. If worse comes to worse, I've got some spray lithium grease I can work up into some of these tighter spots if I have to, but it looks like all the things I need to touch are readily accessible. So I'll go ahead and do that and let you guys see the final result, and hopefully this thing's gonna work. Before I get started on the turntable, I came back here to the actual console stereo where the turntable was, and there's definitely something furry back there. And that's actually my cat. He's sitting in front of the shop light that I had to illuminate the underside of the turntable, and I've never seen a cat do that, and I'm not really sure why he's doing that. That's a 500 watt light, and I'm sure that's really, really hot for him. So I guess he thinks he's at a tanning salon, but anyway, I'll go ahead and unplug that and get back to doing the turntable. Well, now I got the platter taken off, which wasn't too bad of a job. And you can see how that's been wearing, actually, how dried up that grease is down in there. And on top of that was actually a little roller bearing that came on there. And its grease is actually somewhat more slippery, but all that black is oxidation. It's all hard and crusty and sticky, carbonized grease. So I'm gonna take that and soak it in some carburetor cleaner and get that spotless, and then re-lubricate that. And here's the other bearing surface there that rode on those roller ball bearings. Gotta clean that off as well too, but you can see it's already started to show signs of wear just from lack of lubrication. This is a nice platter. Nice big heavy platter to act as a flywheel for good stability. So let me get that stuff. And then here's the motor, which drives this larger gear, and I'm surprised that there's not a dimple right there from sitting so long. So that's really good news. And as this rotates, you can see it start to work right there. So now it's parked, and when I turn it on, it's going to try to move that tone arm. And so I'm glad I pulled off the platter, because it does expose some other wear points right here that are going to need some attention as well too. Still not too bad, everything moves, but just want to prevent any further wear, then get to as smooth of action as possible. And plus, it's really dirty because nobody can clean back down in there unless you pull the platter off. And then right here is a little micro switch that tells the system when you're done and goes ahead and returns the tone arm back to where it belongs. So let me get the bearings all cleaned up and be right back. I went to take this bearing out to get clean with some brake cleaner or carburetor cleaner. Started working on it, and it's kind of cool actually. This is packed with grease, as you can see here on the tip of the screwdriver. It's very old grease, but that's actually really nice, because I can clean all this out of here, out of that channel, and then kind of repack that just like an automotive wheel bearing. So let me get all that crud out of there and show you guys the result. Now what I'm going to do is take some compressed air and blow all this debris out of here that I showed you earlier. This might be, oops, I gotta get some air pressure going on. Maybe 50 pounds ought to do it. Might be somewhat loud. Alright, so we got a good initial cleaning, and I think I'll wipe up the rest of it with a paper towel for the remainder. Okay, I got this bearing cage as clean as I can get it. These bearings are captive and won't come out, but that brake cleaner did an awesome job. I'm going to repack that with some standard white lithium grease that I have for hood hinges and door hinges and things like that for cars. So I'll pack that in there just like I would a wheel bearing on a car. And I've got the other bearing surface all cleaned up. You can tell where the slight bit of wear was, no big deal, but it's all nice and shiny and polished. And same thing for the bearing surface down in there. All nice and clean now and free. And I'm going to pull off this wheel here. I already got the retainer off. There's not a whole lot of play in it. I'm going to pull that off and lubricate down in that shaft with a shot of grease as well too. It's amazing how good a shape these wheels are. This rubber is still nice and tacky, kind of sticky, and really has good traction on that motor. So let me get that done. Okay, now I got this roller cage bearing all cleaned up and repacked with the white lithium grease. So that's looking much better than it was before. And I've also got a dab of grease on the shaft here for this wheel, as well as a shot of grease inside the spindle. So I'm going to go ahead and put that back on. Feels really good. I'm going to wipe off the excess in just a minute. Just kind of want to work that in there as much as I can. And I've also lubricated this channel here. It runs very smooth now, as well as this arm right here. So now I just need to put some of the bearings back together, put on the retainer and washer for this wheel here, and then of course put on the turntable, and then I'll be done with the maintenance of the top side of the record player, and then I can continue on with the bottom side. Okay, got the pulley that was right here installed with the snap ring on it, and then I've got the platter installed and got its snap ring back in place, which was a bit of a challenge I'll share with you guys. If you're restoring a turntable like this, there's a little notch right there in that shaft, and that's the only notch on the entire shaft. So this snap ring must go in this position and this position only, which is about the 3 o'clock position. Otherwise you'll be fighting all day long trying to get that in there. So now let's see just how easily this thing spins. Just keeps going and going and going. It's a really good lubrication there, just like it's supposed to be. So now to get back to work on the bottom side. Okay, I think I've got the underside just about as clean as I can get it. You can see the nasty residue that came off, as well as the dirty grease on the Q-tips. So the brake cleaner is actually doing a really good job. So now it's time to apply some grease to all these pivot points along here and here and everywhere in between, and see how good we can get this action. Especially this arm right there, which was completely dry. This is the arm that holds the record and then drops it down onto the platter. So that's actually pretty rough. So let me apply the grease and see how much better we can make this guy. Okay, I think I've finally finished lubricating all of the wear surfaces as best I could. And I also took off these RCA cables and cleaned under there to make sure they're making good contact, as well as lubricated the arm that holds the record up. So, and then also on this main gear here, I haven't really turned it on yet because I got it sitting here on the counter, but I think once I get it going, the grease on these gears should distribute throughout the entire system and further act to lubricate it. So now this is really more of a, instead of a restoration, it's more of a lube job. I mean, if I really had my druthers and wanted to do it right, could take apart the entire assembly, but a lot of times when you do that, you end up getting more than you bargained for. There's all kinds of adjustments that would get out of specification when you do that. So a lot of times it's just better to leave well enough alone and just give it some good PM or preventive maintenance. So I think this thing is now ready to go back into the console over there. So I'll go ahead and do that and go for a little test drive. Okay, now I got everything put back in and put together. I got the clips installed for the retainers, and power connections made, and audio connections made. And so that's how it looks inside the unit. And now I'll go ahead and take it for a test drive, see how it sounds. I got a album Electric Light Orchestra Discovery, and we'll go to full auto mode and see what happens here. So turning it on actually turns on the unit in phono, and now we'll slide it over to auto. Sounds pretty good. So I think that's a good repair. Everything seemed like it worked okay. And we can go ahead and shut it off. And move the arm back. And now we're ready for the next record. So I'm pretty happy with it. Today is the first day I've actually used this turntable in this 1967 Magnavox Magnasonic console stereo, and I'm glad I got it working. I've never done any kind of maintenance on a turntable before and haven't really played records in a long time. So it was actually kind of refreshing to go through all the steps needed to do the proper maintenance, and think I'll actually play more records. I got a few records, not much. They're all over here in this section. I got some Genesis, Invisible Touch, as well as Jefferson Starship. A lot of older stuff. And some Steely Dan, Countdown to Ecstasy. And some stuff from the 80s. Got some Men at Work. And I think the guy that played the flute in this band just died last month. A High Voltage album, which is really just a compilation of various 80s songs. Got some Ahmad Jamal, some jazz. Really nice album. And got some more jazz from the late 60s. And let's see what else. Art of Noise. Not sure if you guys remember this band, but they were popular back in the 80s. Some Culture Club, which was definitely very popular back in the 80s. And then, last but not least, another generic album that had just several compilations of songs from different artists. So there you have it. Some preventive maintenance and a partial restoration on the Magnavox console stereo turntable. Hope that's helpful to you guys if you have a turntable like this or something very similar.